Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you have joined from. This is a super exciting moment for all of us at Data Platform Geeks. My name is Amit Bansal, and I am privileged and honored to be the host of today's webinar, simply because we have the Bob Ward today for all of you. Before we switch over to Bob's slides and hand over the stage to Bob, a few words as we move forward. My name is Amit Bansal. I'm going to be your host for today's webinar. And along with me, I have Satya Ramesh, Rohit Reddy, and our entire Data Platform Geeks team today. Under eDominer, we do many things. But yes, our focus for today is Data Platform Geeks and SQL Server Geeks, a community that was started about 15 years ago and has become very vast. You all will be very happy to know that we have more than 2,35,000 members on dataplatformgeeks.com. And Microsoft has supported us very positively in last few years and have helped us with our community efforts. One of the things that we do under Data Platform Geeks, apart from the free webinars and events, is the annual summit for India and the Asian countries, where Microsoft experts from Redmond's global MVPs and veterans from more than 16 countries join us every year in the month of August in Bangalore. And as someone has rightly said, a picture speaks a thousand words. Here is the picture that you would all love to see. This was the group photograph that was taken immediately after Rohan Kumar's keynote in the month of August. That was the first day of the conference. We will share these slides with you, and you can click on all the links and explore more. And I'm very happy to let you all know that we have started working towards next year's summit, which is Data Platform Summit 2019. The dates are out, which is August 22nd to 24th and 19 to 21 for the pre-conference. So go ahead and you could just go ahead and pre-register and show your interest. Some people ask me, why this summit? Why should you care? Well, I have a very simple answer. If you really care about Microsoft Data Platform and the projects that you do and all the innovations that you do on SQL Server, this is the summit you should come to, because this is the place where you get to learn directly from people who make the product. You learn from people who have hands-on experience, decades of notes from the field, and this is the place to meet industry veterans. So whether it is reskilling, upskilling, or getting deep technical content by world's best, this is the place. So the website is up, dps10.com, and you can just go ahead and pre-register. That's just like a small form which you got to fill it out. Well, a quick introduction about the Data Platform Geeks core team. So I'm Amit Bansal, and we have our colleagues Manohar, Avinish, Sandeep, Prince, Surbi, and of course, very recently, we have Vijay, who has joined from Hyderabad. They all help us with our community efforts, so big thanks to them. This is very heavily supported by eDominer teams in Bangalore and Calcutta, so we are very grateful to them as well. And this was in Data Platform Summit this year in the month of August. And you can see the entire team on stage. So wonderful moment for all of us. I want to take a moment to thank Microsoft. Today, who we are, what we are, and we exist. Our entire existence is based on the great support we have received from Microsoft across various countries, from India, from Redmond. So special thanks to Microsoft. Data Platform Geeks is a community. All of you are probably members. If not, just go ahead and become members. Apart from free webinars and events, you can join, you can watch our videos, magazines, and a lot more learning resources out there. Here are some groups. My colleague Satya will give these links in the chat window or on email later on. I don't want to spend much time on them right now. Important links on YouTube. So all our webinars are recorded and they will be put up on YouTube. So that first link is important for you, youtube.com/SQL Server Geeks. Now, friends, time has come. We have Bob Ward with us today. I wanted to show this picture to all of you. This is Bob Ward with our Data Platform Summit conference in the year 2016. We were very delighted, very honored to host him. Since then, which is 2016, he was not able to make to the other years. And we are very, we are keeping our fingers crossed if he can make to the summit in the coming year in 2019. So this is a picture, a great pick that we cherish a lot. So friends, without any further ado, we have Bob Ward with us today talking about SQL Server 2019. And I probably think this is one of the first webinars, global webinars broadcasted directly from from the US, from Bob's home. So let me talk a little about Bob. So Bob is working as the principal architect in Microsoft SQL Server Data Services Group, which owns the development of all SQL Server versions. The greatest thing has been that Bob has been working with Microsoft, and with the first release of SQL Server, it has been over 25 years. So from the first release, OS 2.1, all the way to SQL Server 2019, including Linux. This is just incredible. Bob is very popular, and I personally call him the SQL Server legend. And ladies and gentlemen, here is the Bob Award for you. Bob, over to you.
Amit, thank you so much. I need to hire you, Amit. I need to make you my personal agent. I love that introduction. That's quite humbling and honoring. So thank you so much for having me here. Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening to you today. Let me go ahead and share out my screen. Make sure I've got this correctly here, Amit. Let's see. Can you guys see that okay?
Yes, looks good.
Okay, perfect. So yeah, again, thank you so much. Amit reached out to me several weeks ago. We were talking about things we could do together since I've not been able to come to the summit for the last couple of years. And I said, hey, you know, why don't we do something remote? I know you do a webinar series. And he said, that would be really terrific if you could join. And I'm so honored and incredibly impressed that many of you here tonight that are listening in and using the tool to listen in are probably like in the evening time in your homes. So it just speaks volumes to the amazing energy and excitement that those are members of the Data Platform Geeks community have for SQL Server. So we thank you. Microsoft thanks you for your commitment and your dedication and your interest and energy towards it. You know, it's funny, as Amit was talking, I was thinking about the evolution of SQL Server Geeks to Data Platform Geeks. And it speaks volumes to the evolution of SQL Server. You notice here the title of today's talk is SQL Server 2019, the Unified Data Platform. And that's exactly what we think of today's SQL Server. Amit talked about my experience here at Microsoft, starting with OS 2.1.1, which probably, unfortunately, now that I think about it, many of you on the phone probably weren't born when I was working on that product. But it was an engine. It was a database engine of small nature, and it's grown to be an amazing database engine, but it's now a data platform. And that's what I'd like to do today for the next hour or so, is talk to you about why SQL Server 2019, we feel, is perhaps your unified data platform to use for your data needs. Now, a couple things. I'm a big believer in everyone having content, access to content and demos. And I think this is being recorded, but you look at these two websites right here, aka.ms, BobWordMS, and aka.ms, BobSQL Demos. Those are two sites that you can go to even right now and find this deck that I'm presenting you today. And the BobSQL Demos is a GitHub repo that has many of the demonstrations I'm going to show you about SQL 19 today, because I am going to show you a few demos. I'm kind of a big believer in demonstrating what you're talking about. Plus, it just takes a great break from doing slideware. So let's kind of get into the discussion today. And let's just talk first of all about SQL 19. Like, why are we doing this? What's really the overall value to you as a customer and thinking about SQL 19 as a release? Let me just make a comment first about why is it SQL 19? So we released SQL 16 right on the heels of SQL 12 and SQL 14, and you kind of thought maybe as a user of SQL, we're on a rhythm for like maybe every couple of years releasing SQL. Well, we kind of surprised a lot of people by SQL 17 coming a year later, a little bit over a year later from SQL 16, and there's a big reason for that. One is that we wanted to get SQL Server on Linux as a platform and as a choice for our customers. And it was really important for us to get to the market as soon as we could with right quality and performance, and we did that. But to be honest with you, it was our intention at that point in time to release SQL Server about as fast as we could as possible, at the same time making sure that we delivered quality and something of great value. You know, Connor Cunningham, our lead architect for the release of SQL Server, has told me many times, because of our new engineering processes, our cloud-first approach, our DevOps approach, we literally could release SQL Server every month if we wanted to. But we got to make sure that when we do that, it has quality and it has something of value to you. So we're not going to release it every month. You'll see that our CTP releases for like SQL 19 previews may come out every month. But what we want to make sure is we do something that really does have a significant unique aspect from one release to the next. And so we really wanted to release SQL Server 2019 in 18. But as you see on this diagram right here in this slide on the left-hand side, we're doing something fairly big. something called big data clusters. And that's not something that's trivial. And so therefore, we made it a conscious decision that we would announce SQL 19 in this calendar year, but that we would release SQL Server 19 in calendar year 2019. Which goes to an answer to a question I get often, which is, when will you release SQL Server 2019? You announced the preview at Microsoft Ignite here just recently, but I'd like to know, when is this coming out? And I'll just say, in a somewhat humorous manner, but also in a truth, is that we will not become the first product at Microsoft to not make a name. So we picked SQL Server 19 because we think we can release this software for general availability next calendar year, but we haven't picked a date yet. What you're going to see from us, and we just released, announced at the latest PaaS Summit last week, is a new CTP version, CTP 2.1, and you'll continue to see us iterate with community technology preview releases with new enhancements, which I'm going to talk some about today, throughout the rest of this year and the next calendar year. So we haven't picked an exact date yet. We want your feedback. We want your use of this software, but it will be in calendar year 2019 next year. So just real quickly, just let me give you a pan of what this looks like, and let's just kind of, then we'll dive more into kind of real functionality. And that is, on the left-hand side here, we say this word intelligent over any data, because that is part of our new platform, is that we would like to be able to be a hub or a unified platform for you for any of your data. And so we announced something called Big Data Clusters, which provides some interesting functionality. We kind of rocked the industry a little bit when we announced this. We are providing SQL Server capabilities in a new integrated way with structured and unstructured data, including the power of Apache Spark built in with the box with SQL Server, kind of coexisting with SQL. And I'll show you a slide in a second what I mean by coexisting across your data. You see, kind of as you move to the right here, you know, in SQL 17, us announcing SQL Server on Linux and Docker containers, and that's been a big part of what I've been doing over the last year. But also noticing here, this icon for Kubernetes. And so we want to make sure that you understand that we're extremely excited, extremely serious about making sure that SQL Server is a choice for any platform you need. It doesn't mean we're favoring one platform or the other. We still love Windows Server as a great platform for SQL, but we want to make sure that these different platforms like Kubernetes or Docker containers is something that we play in that space. We're very serious about our platform working there, and we want you to be able to have those options as you move forward with your projects and your applications. And then also you see languages. We want to make sure that whatever is the language of your preference, whatever makes sense for your application, we have full support for SQL on that. And you see the different language options that we have listed here, and that's an evolution for us. I think back to OS2, somebody asked me at the latest PaaS event, hey Bob, you know, what was it like back in the early days of SQL? And it was all about Visual Basic. You know, Visual C and Visual Basic running over Novell networks to a SQL server on a small machine. And you think about all the different languages we support now at different platforms, it's really come a long way. And you look in the middle there, performance is something that we've certainly evolved over time for SQL Server from the small engine now to the actual industry leading in performance. And we demonstrate that with our benchmarks. And we'll continue to do that with SQL 19 with new benchmarks as the release comes to general availability. But one thing that's not obvious as you see this slide here is two things. One is our price performance, which we've always been a leader in that. It's something we pride ourselves on. And two is new performance capabilities. You'll hear us talk today, you'll hear me talk today about a capability called intelligent query processing. And so you think about being fast, we really, really believe it and seriously in making sure we have the industry leading performance platform, but also keeping you fast, doing things for query tuning, query diagnostics, and our query processor to keep your applications running quickly. Security is an important part of any data platform. We take it very seriously. This chart right here is not something we made up. This is from the NIST organization that actually measures vulnerabilities for data platforms. As you can see, we're the industry leader over the last decade, pretty much. But we also have security features that help you keep your SQL Server secure, and we'll talk about those today as well. And then finally to the right, you know, BI is still an important technology for SQL Server. And you think about things like Power BI Report Server, that is still an important part of our strategy with SQL Server reporting services. And so it's a great, rich, integrated experience with your BI technologies integrated with SQL Server. And look at the bottom of the slide here. We are very, very serious to make sure about the future, which is why data platform is an important topic, by the way, or a name, because we want SQL Server to be thought of as a platform that runs in your cloud or in a public cloud environment. So you think about our work in managed instance recently with Azure, which has really brought the feature set very close to like SQL Server running in a public cloud, yet with all the great feature and functionalities of a platform as a service. And then in-memory technologies like column store and in-memory OLTP are very serious technologies for us to ensure that we run across those paradigms. And then, as I said, we're very, very serious about providing value to you at a great cost and value. And we are very strong in our belief, and we can prove that we have information to show that we're 1/10 the cost of running on a platform like Oracle. So if you think about this concept called big data clusters, what does that mean, really? And we'll talk briefly about that, and then we'll dive in also some features about the SQL Server engine. And what is intelligence over all your data? Well, we would really like to be thought of as a platform for you to be able to integrate your data without moving your data. You think about ETL processes that you use today in an environment, you've got lots of different data sources besides SQL Server, and you probably find yourself shuffling data all over the place. So can we be the platform that allows you to integrate data and access it with performance without a lot of data movement? Well, if you've got to do that, you've got to be able to manage all of this. And so if you're going to build something like a big data cluster that has this integration story, you have to have a management paradigm. And we would like to be able to say that we will be a vendor that provides all the tools and control planes necessary to manage all of that. And then you want to do analysis. You don't just want to have all your data integrated. You don't just want to be able to manage it. But you got to build apps, and especially things like artificial intelligence and machine learning models across all of that. So you need a platform that supports of it. And so we kind of think that our big data cluster technology can give you that. Integration, management, and analyzation, and AI on top of all those resources. And if you think about that being our aspiration, well, how are you going to do it? Well, first of all, we're going to try to give you SQL Server as a platform to, first of all, connect to all of this. And that includes things like NoSQL and Hadoop and HDFS systems in different ways that we've not done before. And then bringing in technologies like Spark and actually integrating SQL Server in a new way with big data clusters so you can do this intelligence piece we talked about. And then you want a single pane of glass to manage this thing. And so we have this tool called Azure Data Studio, which I'll talk towards the end of this discussion, that we announced at Microsoft Ignite, and we've enhanced it here in the past summit. It used to be called SQL Operations Studio, and it provides a data exploration and a management type pane of glass across this type environment. The three main scenarios we're going after in this big data cluster are, as a SQL Server person sitting here right now, listening in, looking at this, is a little bit mind-blowing. Because if you see the slide right here, you're probably seeing terms and technologies that are not familiar to you. You may be on the phone, though, listening in going, yeah, I know Spark. I know AI and machine learning. And so you may be excited about the fact that we're bringing all these technologies to play in SQL Server in the box itself in one product. So on the left-hand side, the first paradigm is data virtualization. This is about the connection to data other than just SQL Server. And so we're extending this concept that we released in SQL 16 called Polybase in a new and interesting way. First of all, SQL Server 19 will have extensions to the Polybase functionality set aside from big data clusters. So you can just have new external tables, things like MongoDB or Oracle or other different types of data integrated with SQL Server through an external table concept. And this is not data movement. This is actually virtualizing your queries across these data sources. But just having that capability is interesting, but if you want it to be really performant, you may need some other types of structure and platform. And so big data clusters will allow you to access these external tables in a different way using this concept called compute and data pools. And I'll show you a diagram that kind of iterates a little bit more on talking about that. So if you think about a data lake in your environment, a lot of people think about the term data lake in their private cloud environment. It usually involves technologies like HDFS. HDFS being a very scalable structure environment for non-structured data. And a lot of people look at data lakes and HDFS being a core of that. So if SQL Server wants to build a big data cluster that allows you to build a data lake, you're going to need HDFS as technology. So SQL Server 2019 big data clusters include HDFS. And if you think about Spark as being a new incredible technology that's out there in the industry across HDFS type data for high volume data processing, we include Apache Spark too as part of it. But what about SQL Server? Like, how does it play in this game? It's interesting just to bring Spark and HDFS, but a lot of other big data products have that. But SQL Server is an interesting product, an interesting data place platform engine that is very, very smart about how it processes data and especially how it reads and writes data. So we're integrating SQL Server in a new way to directly go against HDFS clusters where the engine itself natively understands how to read and write data from that cluster. So you think about your data virtualization as one part of this to access all the data. Then you think about the power of a data platform to actually store the data and get access to it. That's kind of what the middle looks like. And then on top of that, admin portal management control plane services. And then to the right, you may be today out there thinking, I've got a data lake, I've got this data, structured and unstructured, but AI and machine learning models are part of our new application paradigm. It's no longer just client-server data-driven apps. It's actually artificial intelligence as being built as part of an application, a model, a part of an application project. And so we are including things like Spark ML and our own SQL Server machine learning services to build what we think is a complete AI platform. Now you can prep, train, and execute and operation your models all within this big data cluster environment at scale using technologies like SQL Server machine learning services and Spark ML. And then you think about possible futures here. What if you could actually take these machine learning models and expose them as like an application in themselves? And there's different ways to do that today, but what if, for example, this big data cluster, there was just a simple REST API sitting on top of these models that were operationalized, and you could access them, and they could run at scale in your system. So this is a big picture overall of what we think we're providing and what we think you might find interesting with big data clusters. So what about the technology itself? Like, you may be a technical person thinking, I really want to know kind of the bits and bytes of what you're doing with this. So I mentioned earlier about our future of things like containers and Kubernetes. So our big data cluster technologies, as you look at the bottom layer of this, is going to actually rely on Kubernetes as an infrastructure and a platform to run the cluster. And so if you've ever looked at Kubernetes, it has the concept of persistent storage and things called nodes and pods. And so our big data cluster technology will work natively with Kubernetes using persistent storage, nodes, pods, and containers. And if you look at this diagram at the top, you'll notice that your applications usually connect to a SQL Server instance. In the big data cluster world, we call that a master instance, which is just a normal SQL Server, a SQL 19 instance running in this Kubernetes type environment. Or excuse me, not running, it could be running outside your Kubernetes environment or in your Kubernetes environment. So you connect to SQL Server, and first out of the gate, we are going to build a pool of pods within Kubernetes to store the data and access directly stored data in HDFS. And so what you look at here is an example of a Kubernetes pod with two SQL Server containers, three containers, one running SQL Server, one HDFS, and one Spark. And the reason why these are separated is that SQL Server's been enhanced now to directly read native HDFS data, like JSON data or Parquet files, just like it would read MDF or LDF files. So you have the ability to go to your SQL master instance and query and read directly based on T-SQL skills that you already have today, data stored in your HDFS nodes, or you're going to have the ability to do Spark-like queries in high processing, in-memory streaming formats against this storage pool. Well, that's interesting, but that may not provide the performance you actually need. So it'd be interesting to put on top of that a compute pool of nodes. Think about scale out now, or partitioning a query against this data. You might have even petabytes of data at this HDFS level, unstructured data that you want to run big scale out queries for SQL Server. So we could then introduce new nodes of SQL servers in containers where you can run a query through the compute pool at a partition scale out level to get your storage pool. So that provides now this performant way of getting access to this data. You can kind of see that we have the building blocks now for that vision I talked about. Integration of data, performance of data, management of data, integrating data across this paradigm here. Well, it's one thing to go up against SQL Server and HDFS, but what about other types of data types? So because of this external data format, you have the ability now to create another compute pool to go against other types, like maybe MongoDB, which, by the way, could connect even like Cosmos DB. So you could introduce another compute pool to other sources other than your big data cluster pool here with HDFS. And now you could run T-SQL queries that go across this paradigm. And because you have these compute pools, you're doing it in a partition scalable way. Well, even at that level, every time you access data, it could be that the data you have in some cases doesn't have to be refreshed like every second or every minute. So what if you could cache this data into a data mart? Like, you could run queries, you could build a data mart on the data we've already talked about here. You could cache it in data nodes, and now part of your compute pool could go against this data mart. Now you're talking about very large amounts of data that you could get seconds type response in your data mart to queries that are not updatable all the time, but maybe refresh like daily or even hourly or something of that nature, right? So this is an entire architecture picture of what we're trying to build. And then you throw into that scenarios like IoT. Think about now an IoT platform where you ingest data at scale into this platform, and now you're running queries all on top of it. Now, what's not obvious here, and this is, you're going to see us evolve this diagram as we start keep talking about these technologies, as above this layer where my mouse is moving across, think of something like a control plane where we put services and other tools here to help you manage this entire data infrastructure. So big data cluster technologies is pretty exciting stuff. It's brand new to a lot of you. And it's the kind of value and new innovation we're bringing to SQL 19. It's just new to nothing we've done before. But you can see now why we think it may be a unified data platform for you. Big data clusters right now, SQL 19 is available for you to download right now. Run it on Linux, run on containers, run it on Windows. You can download it, start playing with it, and give me us feedback. Big data clusters is such a new technology in a way that we need to probably manage directly with you. So the way that you access this technology, at least today, is you do an early adopter program with us directly, and then we'll work with you to help set this up and start using the technology and do proof of concepts with it. So all of this resides into a Kubernetes cluster, and that's where that control plane goes on top of that. Well, that's pretty crazy, to be honest with you. When I presented this before to some SQL Server customers who've just used a SQL Server, that's new and a little bit scary. But one thing I want to emphasize to you is that SQL Server and your T-SQL skills and use of things like Azure Data Studio can give you some familiarity with using that technology. So you're going to learn some new stuff, but also using SQL Server as a basis around this should give you great faith that your T-SQL skills and your SQL capabilities are going to apply to be able to use an infrastructure like that. So let's move on and talk about some of the core of SQL Server 19. The heart of SQL Server is definitely these three areas. Anytime we rebuild a new release of SQL Server, we're always thinking about how do we enhance performance, security, and availability. And a lot of the functionality you saw in big data clusters is based on these three paradigms. Connor Cunningham calls this the meat and potatoes of SQL Server, a very American Texan thing to say, meat and potatoes. And what that means, again, is it's the heart. These three areas are ones that we always need to be enhancing and striving to make better, because it is these three areas make up the heart of running the SQL platform for your applications. So let's dive in and talk about some of these. We released in SQL 17 some functionality called adaptive query processing. And here's our thinking. We can fix the query processor in many different ways, the actual code that runs the query processor. But it becomes a very delicate piece of software to try to change. If we make one change in query processor for a given customer, that might have a ripple effect to affect query plans for other customers. And we'll continue to make those changes as we see necessary, sometimes under trace flags or compatibility levels. But the team that builds the query processor are very smart people. And they made a decision in SQL 17 and also in Azure Database, that's where these features kind of first show up, to modify the query processor to do a couple of things. One, could the query processor be smarter or more intelligent to build in operators into query plans that could make adjustments based on the execution of a query, not just when it's compiled? And then second of all, could the query processor adapt or make intelligent decisions based on data or telemetry it receives after you run a query to adjust itself and maybe self-heal or fix a problem that it runs into? And what you're looking at now on this slide is a suite of features we call intelligent query processing. On the left-hand side, these are features not in bold here that shipped in SQL 17. And in the bold is what we've now announced our functionality to be in SQL 19. So let's just talk about a couple examples and I'll show you a demonstration in a second. Memory grant feedback is an important area. So memory grant feedback, memory grants being an area for query processing for sorts and hash type operations, where we have to allocate memory for a query and we have to make that decision upfront. Now that decision may be a problem if cardinality or estimations are wrong. And it's not a matter of the new cardinality model itself. There just could be information where statistics are off or for whatever reason cardinality doesn't work right. And so we can try to fix those problems. But what if there are situations we can't account for where the cardinality is wrong, the grant is wrong, either lower or too big, and we can adjust after you run a query? Well, we release that functionality in SQL 17 for batch mode operations, but now we also do it for row mode. And so think of these really interesting scenarios where today you'd run into a query performance problem, which could really actually cause major issues for your overall server, and you are stuck afterwards trying to figure out what to do. Well, now a query could run that starts hitting a problem like this, but the query processor could adapt itself make intelligent decisions to take telemetry from your first execution or your second execution, adjust the grant on the next execution so that things actually smooth out and run better. That's pretty cool. I'll talk about in a second about table variable deferred compilation, but you see other areas like batch mode processing for row store queries, approximate query processing for count distinct queries, which is really great for big, large warehouse type scenarios. And now, especially exciting in CTB2.1, scalar UDF inlining. So if you're using scalar UDF functions, and those have been a pain point for you in doing performance, for running stored procedures or queries that use that functionality, we can now inline those operations and make them much more faster. That is a significant advancement on query processing for many people. Well, we're not just enhancing the query processor. We're actually doing things to make the for query tuning and diagnostics better. So we've announced that lightweight query profiling, which was only available previously in a trace flag environment or a knob or a switch, is now on by default. And I'll show you a demonstration of how significant that is in a second. My colleague Pedro Lopes, who's really passionate about this, worked really hard as a program manager to get this functionality in. And this is kind of how he views it. You know, get insights anytime or anywhere with a query running on your server. It's one thing just to see what the name of the query is, but I'd like to dive into the query plan as it's running on a live server anytime I want. And you're going to see an example. That's what that functionality gives us. Now, in SQL Server, we really are strive to stay not just, you know, we see a hardware innovation and then we build something. We try to stay ahead of it. We try to stay on top of what's going on in the industry from a hardware perspective. We want SQL Server as a platform and an engine to perform well on it. So we've got two new technologies that take advantage of a technology called persistent memory, a new hardware technology that's been around for a bit, but it's really starting to accelerate in the industry. And this is actual chips that go in your machine that operate pretty much at the speed of RAM, but have persistent storage. So how can SQL Server now take its database engine and recognize one of these devices and take advantage of copying data back and forth like memory copies versus IO operations, making IO performance much more faster? And so we've got now persistent memory enhancements for SQL Server 19 and a new concept we released in SQL 19 CTB2.1 called hybrid buffer pool. So look at our documentation and you can see more information about how, if you're looking at persistent memory, could the engine take advantage of those scenarios? You know, TempDB, I've been through this my career at Microsoft, has been, quite frankly, a pain point in many people's eyes for many, many years, and rightfully so. And in SQL 16, we brought in functionality that our actual setup process would help you configure TempDB files in a way to help you avoid allocation contention problems. And that's been pretty successful. But once you get past this allocation contention problem, you might run into other bottlenecks with a rapid create and drop of temp tables from your application, namely problems with system table contention, things out of your control. Because as you create and drop temp tables, we have to record information or modify tables in system tables in TempDB. Well, just like a SQL Server app in your database, internally, we have to latch pages for these system tables. And if you did not catch this, I encourage you to go back and watch the recording. But at the past keynote, myself and Connor Cunningham demonstrated a planned upcoming feature for SQL 19 where we will implement system tables for TempDB using Hackathon, using memory optimized tables. And we've achieved amazing performance results for TempDB heavy applications where latches just go away now for system tables using internally schema only Hackathon tables. So take a look, that's gonna be coming in the future. It's not available in CTB2.1 today, but we demonstrated that at PASS, and my colleague Pamela Hood also did a demonstration of that at her session in PASS. So that's performance, and let's take a second maybe perhaps and do a demonstration. I think that might be interesting to you. So I've got a machine here, a machine in Azure Virtual Machine, running a SQL Server 19 preview. And what I'm gonna kick off this workload, I'm gonna talk about the workload. Now this is using a popular open source tool called OStress to run this workload. And I'm running multiple users running a stored procedure. Now what does that procedure look like? This procedure looks like the following. It's a very common design pattern for applications. I'm gonna create a procedure, I'm gonna declare a table variable. This is from the Wide World Importers database. So this demo is up in my GitHub repo and you can easily run it yourself. And then I'm gonna insert in this table variable a data from a permanent table in the database. And then I'm gonna join that table variable with another table in my database, giving kind of like an aggregate result. Well, This is problematic for many years for SQL Server developers. And why is that? That's because we've always assumed that any table variable has one row. We have a fixed cardinality estimation that there's only one row in it. Well, you do a join like this to a one row table, and we're going to choose a plan that may not work great if there are a lot of rows in this table. And so the workload that I just ran, that ran in about 30 seconds, you can see here, that was running a procedure with a database compatibility level that was before 2019. Okay, now I'm going to kick off the same workload. All I'm going to do, run the same stored procedure, same number of users, but I'm just going to make the compatibility level of the database to be the same one as SQL 19. I'm going to kick this off. It's running the same stored procedure. And my expectations are is this to run faster. And why is that? Because intelligent query processing has a new functionality to make decisions, what we call deferred compilation. You know, this ran like 3 times faster now. We defer the compilation of a plan using that table variable until we see the amount of data flowing into this. So I'm going to use query store as a functionality to show you the difference. Query store is enabled for this database. I'm going to run my top resource performing query to see what took the most in my application. And the right-hand side of here kind of shows you a difference between the same query with a different plan. And so if you look here at the top and I click on this, and I'll let me hover over it, you'll notice that the average duration for this query is about 4 seconds, which may or may not be bad for your application. But in this particular case, if I kind of go and look at the plan built for it, this is doing a scan on top of my table variable, and the estimated number of rows is 1. Well, that's not good because this row has a lot more than 1 row. But since it only had 1 row, we chose to do a nested loops join and make that the outer table because it only has 1 row. That seems logical for the query processor to do that with a 1-row table. Well, unfortunately, it doesn't have 1 row, so making that an outer table is a bad decision. Because of deferred table variable compilation, if you go look at this plan here, we're using the new compatibility level, you can see that the average duration is 180 milliseconds, far faster running this particular plan than the other. If I click on this, you're going to see why. In this particular case, we now have a better estimation that there are some 200,000 rows in this table variable. And in this case, we use a hash join operation, which is much more efficient in this case than doing this nested loops join. But notice to the left over here what we do. We insert what's called an adaptive join operator for this plan. This is showing the combination of multiple features of the intelligent query processing suite, where if there were far less rows in this table, we would switch over to a hash join and not use a nested loops join, or use a different type of operation plan based on the amount of data flowing into the system. In addition, if you go look at this index scan of this table variable, we are using the new batch mode operation for a row store table, which before was only available for column store. So this is actually a combination of 3 of the features of intelligent query processing, all giving you much faster performance. And here's the great thing. I didn't change my application. I just adhered to the new compatibility level of SQL 19, which is a way how you light up this new functionality. And here I get a new, better query plan. And the other good news is that for using Azure Database, this functionality is all available in Azure SQL Database or a managed instance. Now, Query Store gives some really great functionality, allowing you to dive into differences of queries. So this is a join where I'm looking at the actual query. Let me get the right query ID here. 41998 is my query ID. Everything's a query ID in Query Store. So when I run this particular query, you'll find some interesting results. This is showing me that the previous compatibility level had an average duration of 4 seconds. The new compat level now has an average duration of 190 milliseconds. Query Store records the compatibility level of any new plan and also the version of SQL Server. So you can do some interesting comparisons as you want to change compat levels or even update a cumulative update with Query Store to see what are the plan differences, what are the performance characteristics between these versions. So that's pretty interesting, and that's a demonstration of intelligent query processing. But I also mentioned to you that I had the ability to do lightweight query profiling by default. So I'd like to show you that as well. Let me take away these particular queries. So over here in my command window, and again, this is available for you in my GitHub repo, I have lightweight query profiling. I have a query called My Smart Query. And for those that folks that know me and see that I present know that I'm a little bit sarcastic. So my smart query is probably an indication to you that it's not a very smart query. Anyways, I'm going to look at Activity Monitor. I'm going to find this running query here, and I'm going to see it's running right here. And I'm going to do something very interesting. I think that's the query. Whoops. Let me go back and kick this off again so I can get the timing that I'm looking for. Go back and look here. Ah, this is what I want to see. Whoops. Let me go here. I want to get sure I get the right database I'm looking for. Okay, give me 1 second here. I'm not sure why that's not showing up what I wanted to show. Give me 1 second. Ah, there we go. So what I'm showing you is a query that's running on SQL Server, and I'm live, not just looking at the text of the query, I'm looking at the actual query plan in the middle of its execution as it's running. So think about this scenario. You run into a SQL Server, you all of a sudden have some massive high CPU utilization or some issue that you think is going on with the server. You can then go into Activity Monitor or some DMV or whatever you want to use and see which queries are running. But what you can't do is see the plan of the query that's running. Now, through this operator here, through graphical interfaces, you can do this, or with DMVs, you can do the same thing. You can now see the current execution of plans as they run inside SQL Server. That was only available before with a trace flag or a knob in SQL, and that's built in default to SQL. And this is really nice because if I go in, I can look at this, I can immediately see here with this red X showing over here that there's probably a problem with the plan that's built. It just doesn't look right to me. Two scans and this red X across this join is not correct. And I can see the query as well, and you'll notice here that what's happening is I'm joining two different tables, but my join clause is wrong. So I could choose to kill this query at this point and go back and talk to the developer and say, hey, you made a mistake with your query. I might not have noticed that query text being incorrect unless I'd seen this incorrect plan. Now, it might not always look like that, but the point is you could look at the execution of a current plan and notice a problem with it, whereas before you'd have to go after the fact to see the problem. Seeing it anytime, anywhere is a very powerful feature now of SQL Server, and it runs by default. And the reason we chose to put it on by default is because it does not have a performance impact for your application. We would not choose to do that if we thought that it would have that impact. And so that's why we're proud to announce that on SQL 19, we can put that in default. So take a look at those two functionalities. Those are examples of intelligent query processing, new features in SQL Server that we think you're going to find in SQL 19 exciting to use and help you build faster applications and tune and diagnose faster applications. Okay, that's performance. What about security? You know, I talked about performance, security, and availability, and we always are really, really serious about making sure the SQL Server has very few vulnerabilities as far as security problems go, but also having you the right features and functionalities. And SQL 19, that's no different. We released in SQL 16 a functionality called Always Encrypted, and it was a great technology, right? Because it's end-to-end encryption to help you with man-of-the-middle attacks. It also operates a separation of duties where the keys to unencrypt the data are not available to database and system administrators. The keys are somewhere else. In fact, the keys are kind of in control of the application. But here's one of the problems with that. Because we're always unencrypting only on the client side, the ability to do rich query processing like light queries or range scans and various types of things, you only could do a quality operations. You couldn't do different types of rich query processing that you wanted in this environment. And plus you had this ability where even separation of duties may not always be pure because of data being encrypted in the SQL Server database. Well, there's this concept called secure enclaves, which is now available at the processor level with chips from companies like Intel and AMD, and also at a virtual level with Windows Server 19. Now, I'm proud to announce that SQL 19, Always Encrypted, will integrate with secure enclaves. And so you see in this diagram here that with a secure enclave, say at a hardware chip level, all the encryption and unencryption happens at the chip on the server, but it's protected. So it still offers separation of duties, but it's faster from an unencryption point of view, and it allows always encryption in SQL Server to provide richer functionalities for query processing. It's still an end-to-end encryption story. There's not unencrypted data across the wire, but that's actually the beauty of it, is all the things happen at a chip level on the machine in a secured way that makes things much faster and much more robust for query processing. In the SQL 17 timeframe, we introduced data classification tools and vulnerability assessments into Management Studio and into Azure Database. Well, I'm proud to announce in SQL 19, data classification is now built into the SQL Server engine at the metadata level through T-SQL. So now, if you would like to label your SQL Server columns and tables in a way, say for GDPR purposes, you can do that inside SQL Server itself and not have to rely just on a tool. Well, why does that matter? Well, number one, you now have better capabilities as a developer to build your own apps for classification purposes. What's more important is, because it's built in the SQL Server metadata, when you use our auditing functionality, you have auditing built in. So now if you classify your data, say for GDPR, you can run auditing queries to see which user and which queries access data that was labeled for that purpose. That's an important functionality for you to be able to adhere to GDPR and offer data for classification in general. You want data classification built into the metadata of your database and your application, and you also want the ability to audit any access to classified type data. So that's all built into SQL 19 in the functionality of the engine itself. We make a certificate management easier, for example, managing certificates across clusters, across multiple machines involving SQL instances can be done through SQL Configuration Manager. And the new functionality that has planned to announce that will be coming in SQL Server Management Studio in our toolset is something called static data masking. We had dynamic data masking in SQL 17, where through DDL, you dynamically could configure DDL and data would be masked from an application. But in those situations, people that had T-SQL access could still see unmasked data. Well, now with static data masking, you can take, for example, a subset, maybe production data, you can mask it where it'll be masked and ingrained into the data itself, and then hand a copy of that database to somebody else who just shouldn't have access to it. So static data masking is a tool that allows you to mask data and burn that mask into the data itself, and then allows you to take, you know, scrubbed versions of your database to other people that may need to use it for testing or development purposes. So that's coming in our tool set for SQL 19. Let's talk about availability. We got some exciting stuff to talk about here that I think you're gonna really like. So first of all, we continue on this journey of making sure that index maintenance is more available for you. So index, resumable online index creation is now available, as well as rebuild from SQL 17. And clustered column store indexes can now be created and rebuilt online, whereas non-clustered was available in previous versions. We have some enhancements for always-on availability groups. We continue to enhance that functionality. We provide a new connection directive for primary writable type queries that want to make sure that their application is always directed to the primary, not just for secondary read capabilities. And then we were proud to announce availability group capabilities for Kubernetes. In SQL 17, you had the ability for Kubernetes functionality to be done at the shared level so that you could automatically set up a SQL Server container on a Kubernetes cluster. And because Kubernetes has built-in high availability from a shared storage point of view, almost like a failover cluster instance, you just get built-in functionality for high availability. But the problem is that Kubernetes didn't know anything about the health of SQL Server. It just knows whether the pod's running or the actual container's running. And it also requires scenarios where failover time could be in minutes instead of something faster. So with AGs on Kubernetes, we have some pretty new cool concepts that you can run and try yourself today. First of all, we introduced a concept called an operator, which is part of the Kubernetes nomenclature. Our operator does something very unique. When you go and try our operator for AGs, it automatically behind the scenes deploys an AG infrastructure for you. So once you deploy the operator, you're automatically set up with something like the following. You could have three nodes here, and in this particular case, you'll have pods in these nodes that have a primary and two secondaries with a new piece of software in a container called an AG agent, which behind the scenes will be the ones detecting health of the actual SQL Server and using Kubernetes commands and infrastructure to do failover capabilities. So now you've got the whole AG infrastructure built in. And when you set this operator up, it's incredible. Your AGs are all just running now. The only thing you need to do is add a database to the primary, and then direct seeding would handle going over your secondaries. So in the matter of just a few commands in Kubernetes and then a simple T-SQL command to add your database to the availability group, you have an AG up and running, quite frankly, in a matter of minutes. That's actually pretty cool. And it avoids a lot of the configuration mistakes made say in a clustered environment or even in a Linux environment. So that's great and fine, but how are your apps going to react to it? Well, first of all, Kubernetes supports something called the load balancer. It's a built-in service. It's like an external IP address that's static. Your app could connect to this load balancer service. The load balancer can be configured to always point to the primary. So if there's a failover that occurs, the load balancer will be redirected to the new primary, allowing your app to always be pointing to the primary instance. But as you know, AGs have read capabilities, so you could set up a reporting app with another load balancer to always do routing and balancing across your secondaries. So if a failover situation occurred in this environment, the AG agent software can detect this, direct to a new primary, and the load balancer will be directed now to this new primary system. In addition, the secondary load balancer could redirect to secondary once that primary finished and came back up as a new secondary and got resynced. And now you're back to a fully functional AG system after failures have occurred, where the apps are now pointing to the right systems. This is pretty exciting. This is kind of the future of doing HADR in a Kubernetes environment. And we're proud to announce this functionality in SQL 19 for you to kind of try off. And our tutorial will show you how to walk through this in Azure Kubernetes Service. It's pretty interesting to walk through and see how failover work and how new you can use Kubernetes in a new way for both deployment and easier configuration of HADR. So SQL 19 CTP 2 came out with these features and functionalities, pretty exciting things for our customers to see. But we're excited to announce today two new planned features of SQL Server that will be available in future CTPs. One is called accelerated data recovery. If you run into situations today where, unfortunately, a long-running transaction ran in your system, and then all of a sudden SQL Server may take a long time to roll back, or even a rollback took a long time in your system and it caused major outages for you, accelerated data recovery, which is in public preview today for Azure Database and will be available in an upcoming CTP for SQL Server, literally is a game changer, because now the rollback time or the recovery time for your database is constant. No longer is it something you have to worry about for hours and hours of recovery of my database or rollback of a transaction, because we're using a new concept called a persisted version store. We use this version store concept so that we can look at versions of data and only roll back what we need based on versions. I think you're really going to like this. Once you see this functionality come out, and you can try it in Azure today, you can go try out various long-running recovery scenarios, and you can see your SQL Server will be available in a matter of seconds or minutes, much faster than you've run into the past. Now, for availability groups, one of the most commonly requested features we see is that customers love the fact that an availability group is a set of databases that fail over as a unit. You've got database health detection. You've got great health detection for failovers. But here's my problem. I've got SQL agent jobs. I've got logins. I've got other instance-level information that's in system databases, and I need that to be available on the new primary. So I'm proud to announce that we have planned functionality for availability groups for system databases. So now no longer will you have to be able to manage all that information on secondaries now and find some special way to do it. Aside from your availability group for your user databases, we'll support it for system databases and create an integrated story for a complete availability group package. So pretty exciting stuff. My colleague Amit Banerjee announced that at a past summit, and he paused for a second and like the whole room did a standing ovation. So probably you're on the phone just doing your clapping right now that know that we're finally trying to take care of needs that you have for availability for SQL Server. So me being at Microsoft for 25 years, a lot of people don't know, but before I joined the company, I was a developer. I was an actual Unix developer working on Oracle and C++ systems a long time ago. And so I care about developers passionately. I want to make sure that we're providing the right software and the right functionality for developers. And so we've got some new functionality we've been working on, and we've also been working on previous releases for the developer itself. Now, number one is SQL Graph. And we did that in SQL 17. We announced SQL Graph Database. So if you have graph models that are more naturally looking like a graph, there's no longer this crazy munging or ETL that you have to do into a new graph system you bought. You can now use two SQL extensions to actually model tables as nodes and edges and use predicates in the extended T-SQL language to navigate over those models and basically traverse your graph. And we've got new enhancements in SQL 19 to keep down that path. Those enhancements are also available in SQL Azure Database. So Unicode's also been a problem for developers. They build systems. They want Unicode data. Their database administrators are saying, you're taking up too much space with us Unicode character types. So now we natively support UTF-8. Which greatly reduces the amount of size your Unicode columns take up. So now you can feel free to use Unicode types in a way that will not consume as much space, because of course UTF-8 is a more compressed version of Unicode data. Machine learning services is something we announced in SQL 16 with R, and then Python in SQL 17. And I'm proud to tell you today that we have two functionalities we've done. One, we now support machine learning services integrated with cluster services in Windows. So now you can use machine learning with a cluster, a failover cluster. And in addition, we now have machine learning services in Linux. So those functionalities work as well. Well, R and Python are interesting languages. They do certainly support data science models, and they're very popular for data scientists. So machine learning is a natural language for those. But you think about a language like Python, in some cases even R, there's lots of stuff you can do with R code or Python code, right? Well, if you look at on the right-hand side here, this is the architecture of running machine learning services in SQL 17. And in SQL 19, we're proud to announce a new language, Java, into this language set. But I want to make sure you understand how we picture this. Yes, you could use even Java for machine learning services, but now Java becomes an extension of your T-SQL language. Think about any T-SQL functionality that you can't do today. Perhaps you don't even want to write a CLR assembly for this. Now perhaps you have a Java programmer that could bolt that in to T-SQL running on the SQL engine. And the architecture is very important because people ask me this all the time. Like, I'm really nervous to run a Java program or a Python script inside my SQL server. Well, technically it doesn't run inside SQL server. It actually runs on the same computer as SQL server, but we naturally use this process called Launchpad on the same computer to isolate the processes running these programs on the same computer, but with a direct path of talking to data with SQL Server to make them performant. So you shouldn't worry about the fact that your Java code runs inside the SQL process space, maybe causing issues for it. It runs in a separate program on the same computer. And here's the great story. Resource Governor now sits on top of this. So you can use Resource Governor rules to control CPU memory and affinity for these processes, aside from how you affinitize and control SQL Server. So think of these as a way of extending the T-SQL language, but also providing capabilities that are performant and isolated and run at low privilege accounts running on your SQL Server computer. Now, SQL Server Linux, as you know, big announcement for us in SQL 17. I've been spending a lot of time myself on it. And one of the things about SQL 17 on Linux that's really unique is the fact that the core database engine is the same code, binary code running on Windows, because it's just Intel assembly code, right? We had a unique architecture using the platform abstraction layer to make sure the core engine. In fact, Slava Oaks always tells me this quote. He's like, Bob, the query processor is the query processor. It's the exact same code running on both engines. But here's the problem. As we release SQL 17, there are a few features that I call on the edge of the engine, like replication, distributed transactions, and machine learning that were not available on Linux. And I'm proud to tell you that in SQL 19, we now have that functionality. So if you're a transaction replication person and you're worried about running on SQL on Linux, that works. DTC transactions and even machine learning all now run in that environment. And in fact, things like DTC and replication, you can go cross-platform. You could do a publisher on Windows and a subscriber on Linux or vice versa. Same thing with DTC transactions. And so I want to make sure you understand that both for Linux and Windows, that feature gap story is now closed because all of that now is supported on SQL 19. We were even thinking about in the future, is it possible to take that feature gap and move it back into a future cumulative update with SQL 17. We're not ready to make an announcement on that, but that's kind of the thinking we'd like to do. We'd like that to be a story where your choice of SQL Server is your operating system choice, not because SQL Server runs differently, whether it's running on Windows or Linux. Active Directory authentication on Linux has been somewhat problematic and somewhat difficult sometimes for customers, so we now have open LDAP support. So products like Centrify, which are very easy to use to configure AD, is now supported on SQL on Linux. And I've talked about containers, how important they are, the future of what we're doing. They're part of big data clusters. They're part of running anything in Kubernetes. And we've got some enhancements there. We have a new Microsoft Container Registry is where we store our Docker our actual containers now. The Docker Hub and the Red Hat Container Catalog, which we have now Red Hat Container Images, they're there to syndicate and list out those images. But officially, we store things in the Microsoft Container Registry, which is now a global common registry for all Microsoft product containers that are listed. And we've got documentation to show you how to access those. And then, of course, I mentioned always on availability groups in Kubernetes is something we are supporting now in SQL 19. So let me pause for a second here. We've been an hour into this. I know it's been a lot of information, but I'm almost done. But I want to show you a quick demonstration of a few things. First of all, this is a secured shell into a Red Hat Linux VM running SQL 19. But I also have Docker containers running in this environment. So this command right here that I'm running will tell me what containers do I have running on my system. And this shows me I've got a SQL 17 container running CU10 with SQL Server. Now, I want to show you something really amazing. I've got a script here that with Docker will do upgrades like you've never seen before. What I'm going to do is I've got my database pointed onto a shared volume on my Linux host server mapped into the directory where the SQL databases are. So I'm going to stop my SQL 17 container. I'm going to run a new container with SQL 19. And what's going to happen when I do that? So I'll run docker upgrade.sh. And when I run this, I'll go back and run my Docker command. And if I run sudo docker here in this particular case, you're going to see here now my SQL 19 container is running. Well, what have I done when I've really done this? What I'm doing is I'm upgrading my databases from SQL 17 to SQL 19. And the reason I can show you that is I can run this exec into Docker. This allows me to interact with the Docker container that I've run. And when I do this, I can go into the actual error log directory. And you're seeing here, we're running the upgrade scripts for SQL Server. So this is going to take like a matter of a few minutes. And when I'm done, I've effectively upgraded my SQL 17 instance, which is running in a container, to SQL 19 without patching it. Think about the new way now of updating patching SQL Server. At the recent PaaS conference last week, I showed even SQL 17 instances where I switched back and forth between two SQL 17 containers running different cumulative updates, automatically updating and rolling back between them without any patching in a matter of minutes. So I just want you to think in the future, as you think about the new platform of Docker containers, this could be new ways for you to update and upgrade SQL Server and allow you to do things you've not ever done in the past. So that's just one small demo I wanted to show you. And that's all available in my GitHub repo. You can go try all that stuff yourself. Back over here to my Windows VM, I wanted to show you that in here, in Visual Studio Code, is a Java class. My colleague Nelly Gustafsson has given me this Java class. It is using a concept called an ngram, which is a natural language processing concept. But there is no ngram function in T-SQL. So Nelly wrote this Java class where I can go now here into Azure Data Studio and do something like this. I can actually run, I'll go back to this example, I can run with this system stored procedure the ability to execute my Java class, passing in a query that the Java class will process that data and return a result set with my ngram result. So I'm gonna run this ngram function on top of my result set and give a result back. And that's the result of this. And so the really cool thing about Java, of course, is that it's compatible. So I can take this Java class that I wrote, running in T-SQL, I can copy it to my Linux server, and this is what the Linux script looks like. I just have a different path where my Java classes are. It's the exact same code. I just copy the classes over, I run the same thing, and that since that Java extension runs in both environments, I have complete compatibility. So I could go build Java apps now. I think Nelly even demonstrated regular expression processing in PaaS to extend T-SQL and make it completely compatible running across two different environments, both on Windows and Linux. So you're gonna see a lot more from us about Java and how we're extending the T-SQL language with it and different examples, and maybe setting up even community scenarios where community really contributes to making Java a first-class citizen extending the T-SQL language itself. Well, I'm really packing it in today. I hope your heads are kind of almost exploding at this point. That's what you know any Bob Ward presentation is known for. So I kind of hope we're just giving you so much information that you're so excited you're going to start playing with all this stuff when you go back after this talk. So, you know, I've worked in CSS and support for many years before I joined the engineering team, and I provided a lot of feedback to the engineering team based on customers. And now that I've worked inside the engineering team, I don't think people understand. Sometimes it doesn't appear that we're doing this, but we really do listen to feedback from customers. We do really listen to what customers say. I was at PaaS Summit last week, talked to a lot of customers about their opinions about SQL, and we do take this all into effect. And in fact, in the engineering team itself, if you want to get an improvement done inside SQL Server, you have to have customer information behind it. If you don't have customer data, customer testimonials, customer evidence, it's pretty hard to get something done in the product. So you need to understand that it's very important for us that you continue to give us feedback about the product. And so this is a list of some features that we've done in SQL 19 that are smaller in nature, but larger because it's really got a lot of customer evidence behind it. We try to make sure that things like clone database or compression for column stores better. We've added some new diagnostics for auto-stacked blocking scenarios because a lot of customers are running into that. And I'm proud to tell you today that the number one voted feedback item of all time for SQL Server is this very poor message for string truncation. But in SQL 19, it now looks like this. So now for SQL 19, a new error message is available for you, and you have a trace flag to roll back if you don't want this, where we can give you context. So before you had no idea what table, no idea what column, no idea kind of what the sampling of the value was, you now get this information in SQL 19. And I'm proud to tell you, Pedro Lopes, again, great community advocate in our Tiger team, he helped push this through. It's in SQL 19, and SQL 17 has already been backported, and he has plans to backport it even to SQL 16. So a great example of us really taking seriously your votes and delivering on your value. Another thing I showed at the past summit, if you look at this recording, is I was troubleshooting that tempdb latch problem. I was showing Connor Cunningham that a lot of times you'll see page values in terms of latch resources, and you have no idea what object that page belongs to. So let's say, for example, you're looking at a tempdb scenario. You look at a DMV like DM exec requests, you see page numbers, but you don't know, is it a GAM page, an SGAM page? What is it? Well, we now have T-SQL functionality for you to crack a page effectively. You now can take information from a page resource, which is in the form of a database ID, file ID, and page ID. We will crack at that information and allow you to run a function to figure out what does the header of the page look like. So think of running dbcc page now, which is undocumented, and looking at the header information in a supported T-SQL function. And so this is all in our documentation already, but you now have the ability to look at page resources, whether it's deadlocking or blocking or whatever, and get more diagnostics on the exact database and object that that page belongs to, so you can do further diagnostics. I think that's pretty cool. A lot of folks that are SQL geeks, and this is the Data Platform Geek group, so you guys will love it, really like that we're kind of delivering on functionality like this. So let me finish off with a couple of comments. Number one, we introduced at SQL at Microsoft Ignite and at PASS a new tool called Azure Data Studio. But I want to start first with the comment at the bottom of the slide. When we introduced this tool, I got so many questions. Vicky Harp, our lead program manager in this area, got a lot of questions to say, oh, does this mean Management Studio is dead? And the answer is absolutely not. Management Studio is still alive and well. It's still the preferred database administration tool in a Windows environment. It will always run in Windows, but we even announced a new version of it. A preview 18.0 with new functionality built into it. So literally, I've talked to the team that runs this. We are serious about making sure that Management Studio is alive and well. It's still a tool we support. It's still a tool we're enhancing. And in fact, we're trying to bring in these worlds together between what was called SQL Ops Studio, now called Azure Data Studio, and Management Studio. But please take away from this talk that Management Studio is still something you can rely on. And in fact, what I love about it, I still show it up all the time, it is so great because it's compatible to connect to SQL on Linux, SQL on Windows, and SQL Server running containers. But we did introduce a new tool called Azure Data Studio, formerly SQL Ops Studio. And let me just talk briefly about the name, because we've got a lot of questions about the name, and I get why you want to know about the name. First of all, why Azure? This is SQL Server. Why are you calling something Azure? In fact, it's led a lot of people to believe that this tool is not even works with SQL Server. Well, we're trying to do better at it, but I'm here to tell you today that the word Azure to me and to us in the SQL team means hybrid. So this Azure Data Studio tool is intended to connect and do data exploration, data querying, and management of big data clusters for SQL Server, which is part of our hybrid story. In fact, you may not know this, but I work for a team at Microsoft called Azure Data. Rohan Kumar, our VP, is the VP of Azure Data. And I happen to be an engineer and an architect working under that team in SQL Server. It's called Data Studio because it is about data. We announced at SQL Past Summit that this tool today already works with Azure Database, with SQL Server, and even Azure Data Warehouse. And our intention is to make this work with Cosmos DB and other types of data sources, a one-stop shop for that connected experience for your unified data platform. And we're bringing these worlds together. So troubleshooting functionality and management functionality that's in Management Studio, we're trying to bring into Azure Data Studio through our extension marketplace. Our extension marketplace is really impressive, and then you're going to see all sorts of new things from that. Vicky Harp demonstrated at PASS Summit a new concept called notebooks, SQL, T-SQL notebooks, with this new concept called pros. My head exploded when I started seeing this, and I'm excited to start demonstrating for you in the SQL community the new functionality that I find in Azure Data Studio. So SQL 19, that's pretty exciting, Bob. You're probably on the phone now, and I'm hoping, like maybe not tonight, because of those of you that are like late at night, you probably want to go back to your families. They're probably wondering, why are you on this call in the middle of the night here where you live? But maybe tomorrow you want to download SQL 19, which you can do that for free. We've got a Val and Dev editions app for you to work on Windows, on Docker containers and Linux. Or maybe you want to contact us for our EAP program for big data clusters. But what are we thinking about in the future? Like, what are we doing past this? Well, first of all, we will continue in the future CTPs, keep iterating on big data clusters, data virtualization, availability, security, more hardware innovations, more container enhancements, and even more improvements other than the ones I just showed you. So all of those things that you saw me talk about, we'll just keep enhancing those. We'll have new features and functionalities. The things that I announced today that are planned are going to actually be there in CTPs that you can try and test out. But what about that top item? What about SQL Server on Edge? And to be clear what we mean of that, we mean Edge by the term IoT Edge. We think the SQL Server has a unique place as a data platform, as a data engine in this space. So look for us in the future to make announcements and to talk more about how SQL Server as a data platform runs in IoT Edge line devices and even on new and exciting types of machines and devices. So that's kind of our thinking there. We have nothing to announce today, but it's something we're really thinking hard about because we think SQL Server has a differentiator there in that environment as IoT Edge becomes a proliferation of sensors, devices, and certainly a data explosion in your environment applications. And if you would like to talk more about Edge scenarios, you certainly can contact me directly at bobward@microsoft.com. We'd love to hear from you how you think SQL Server can play in this space. And there's all sorts of other stuff I'd like to tell you about. We're not ready to announce yet. But one thing I just want to make a comment on is that being in CSS for so long and certainly spending most of my time working on the current releases of SQL, I'm not sure I've ever seen an engineering team that innovates faster that's outside of Azure than SQL Server. Our team, it seems like every time I'm turning around, I myself am having a hard time keeping up with the investments we're making. But we're not doing this to make it hard for your life. We're not building new investments for SQL Server to make it hard for you. We're doing it because our customers are asking us that. They're like, look, I am on legacy versions of SQL Server. I need to modernize and move to newer versions. But I love the fact that you're staying on top of this technology. You're being innovative because it makes me believe that SQL Server is going to be around for the future, which it is. But think about how we're doing this. We're not just building SQL Server in an innovative way just for SQL Server's sake. We're aligning ourselves with our cloud story. Things like managed instance, things like Azure Data Warehouse are new technologies that may give you confidence that if I'm making investments in SQL Server, can I build part of my application enterprise in the cloud? Can I get the same features there because I want platform as a service? And the answer is yes. And that's something we're working really hard because all of those investments work under Rohan's organization. And so we certainly talk among the teams to make sure, are we lining down that boundary? And many of the features you saw today have showed up in Azure first. You know, it's a cloud first, it's not a cloud only approach, it's a cloud first approach in some cases. And then it makes its way into the box of SQL Server. Well, man, I hope you've enjoyed this today a little bit. We're going to start taking some questions here to finish off today, but I want you to know a few resources for you. This is a website at the top for you to start previewing SQL 19 today yourself, to download it and start looking at it. If you want to join the early adopter program, if you want to look at big data clusters, or if you're really thinking about seriously building a SQL production application with SQL 19, we'd like to talk to you. So there's how to sign up there. And then our What's New documentation for SQL 19, we're always updating that with new CTPs. That's a link there. Before I take questions, it's always an opportunity when you present to make a shameless plug for a book you've written. So I went down this journey. It's hard to believe I've done it, but I went down this journey of writing a book. And this book has just come out. It's now available on A Press Media and on Amazon and sites like Barnes & Noble and Safari Online. The book is available in production today. It's no longer just pre-order. It's on available electronic formats and hard copy formats. And so pretty excited about it. I had a lot of interest and buzz about it at the past summit. The book is written for two types of users. If you're a SQL Server user and you'd like to know about the unique situations of deploying and running SQL on Linux, I think this book is for you. If you're a Linux user that doesn't know much about SQL Server, you will find this is a comprehensive discussion of the SQL Server product and its functionalities. This is not just a difference on Linux book. This is a comprehensive discussion about applications, performance, security, availability, all of those features. And then finally, being here for 25 years, it was fun to write the book because I've got sprinkled in there all sorts of great stories across 25 years of working the SQL Server product with the engineering team, and even some behind the scenes stories of how certain features came to be. So you might find it just for that purpose alone to read some of the history of the product is kind of baked in that book. So love to see feedback on what you think about the book. And so, you can take a look at that today from A Press Media or Amazon or sites like Barnes & Noble, Safari. I'm not sure other types of sites maybe in the country or region you live in the world that publish these books, but you can read more about it at A Press Media and then kind of go from there to try to find copies of the book. Wow, man, that was a lot. And you can see that I have some energy behind this because I'm really excited about the features we're putting into SQL 19 and the strategy we're putting behind it, because it's not just a matter of putting a bunch of features out there. It has to have value and meaning. We have to put these features and functionality because we believe it gives new possibilities for you and your application. So Amit, what do you think, man? I guess we now can stop maybe and do some questions or what do you think?
Of course, Bob. I mean, we would love that you go on and on, but we know you have better things to do, and we have taken a lot from your webinar, and I think we have to go back and read and try and explore a lot of what you have showed today and talked about.
Right. Yeah. It's amazing. As you can see, there's a lot, but you yourself have time to go through and start kind of figuring out what a lot means. So I'm happy to try to take a few questions if you'd like to go through some of these, or it's up to you. How do you guys want to proceed from here?
Yes, Bob. I will just wind up the webinar and we'll straight away jump into the Q&A panel. I can see we have more than 30 questions waiting. So let's see how long it goes, but I'll just quickly wind up. So friends, first of all, friends, all of you and you know the Data Platform Geeks team, eDominer, all of us from here who have attended, a big shout to Bob Ward, and thank you very much, Bob, for this webinar today, for your time. And I'm just trying to play something here. So this is, I just did this and all of you can see this. Today we had 438 attendees from 41 countries.
That's amazing.
This is amazing. This is incredible. So it's like big round of applause for all of you who have joined today. You can't see me, but I wish you could see me and the way I'm cheering this is lovely. This webinar, as I said before, is being recorded, and this is the YouTube channel that you should follow. It's simple, youtube.com/SQL Server Geeks, and we will probably upload it in a day or two. There is a small ask from the Data Platform Geeks team. We will post a webinar pick on LinkedIn and Facebook, so please post your feedback and comments on that picture. We will share the links for both of these social media sites. And what can we ask from you? Well, we can simply ask from you, thank you, Bob Ward and Data Platform Geeks team. Well, that Data Platform Geeks team is optional, but the first one
It was my honor. It was my honor and pleasure to do this. What an amazing turnout. That really blows my mind. That's amazing.
Yes, that is amazing. Incredible. So just for all of you on records, there's a team of 12 people in Data Platform Geeks team that has been working behind in the last 1 month to pull off this webinar and reach out to as many customers and audiences as possible.
Well, thank you, team. Wow, great work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So here are, we will share these links. I will request my colleague Satya to put them down on the chat window. Feel free to ask more questions on the Facebook group, the LinkedIn group. And yes, we also have the community on mobile in case you use Telegram app. If not, you can start using it. We don't use WhatsApp. We use Telegram just because it allows more members in the group. So we will share these links also with you. If you wish to join a few masterclasses from SQL Maestros, here are some links, sqlmaestros.com. A couple of known international experts collaborate, and we bring this all together for the community. So here are the links and the slides. We'll share that also with you on the link. So thank you very much for your time, friends. From 41 countries, amazing. Again, a lot of links there. We'll put them on the slide. So now we will jump into the Q&A panel. And my colleague Satya, myself, and of course, Bob, we are here to answer your questions. So I'm just turning on the Q&A panel. And in the Q&A panel, I can see there are 34 open questions.
Wow.
So yeah, starting okay. from the oldest one to the first one. So Bob, can you see the Q&A panel in front of you?
I do. I see the first one says, what is the use of a data mart? Is that the first one?
Yes, that's the first one. So what we can do, Bob, you can start answering questions and Satya will keep dismissing them as you finish your answer. So
sure.
Bob, over to you with the question and the answer.
Okay, Amit. Yeah, let's go through these. I'll try to do the best I can to answer as much as is possible. So the data mart concept, and we went through a lot of stuff. So you go back to the recording, you'll probably see that. But the idea being of a data mart is that, think of it as like a cached result store. So it's one thing to run compute pool queries at scale across that big data cluster, but there could be scenarios where these queries don't have to be refreshed very frequently. And so the way to make them even more performant is to cache them. And so DataMart allows that capability. You can think of it as just taking a result set across all of that type of data, caching into a SQL server, putting a column store index on it, and boom, you have like really fast queries across very large result sets. So that's what a DataMart is. Hybrid buffer pool. So yeah, that's an interesting one. If you think about this persistent memory concept, think of it just like some RAM, except it has this unique property that it's backed up by a battery source, so like it survives a restart. So if that's the case, it can be treated like a drive, except it has a unique property that it runs at the speed almost of RAM. SQL Server has API capabilities to recognize one of these devices, and then what we can do with hybrid buffer pool is extend and use part of the buffer pool across this device. So think about almost like buffer pool extension for SSD that we announced in previous versions, and then using this new persistent memory in a similar but a different way to accelerate I/O performance. That's hybrid buffer pool, and that works across Windows and Linux systems. So the question is, with features like compute nodes, parallel processing, what's the future of Azure Data Warehouse after it hits release? I'm here to tell you that Azure Data Warehouse has a huge future. Think about what we're building, which is mostly an on-premise private cloud solution using Kubernetes and big data clusters, although it can run in Azure. Azure Data Warehouse is a platform. Let's make sure we're honest about that. That's a platform where you are basically going to be putting data into the system, and then with a separation of compute and storage provisioning and even paying, you get warehouse queries at massive scale. So there's still a great future for Azure Data Warehouse, and I think there's a great future for us. Azure Data Warehouse does offer things like Polybase as a functionality. I think right now we're embarking more on our side to really extend our data sources across like MongoDB and all these different types of sources and use Kubernetes as a basis. But think of Azure Data Warehouse, again, being a full platform as a service to user warehouse needs. And I think there's certainly room for both those technologies to play in a similar but different kind of way. So what's the scope of big data and AI in 19? The scope is crazy amazing. First of all, let's be clear. Machine learning services, which provides AI capabilities with the database engine with R, Python, and Java, that just comes with SQL 19, both on Windows and Linux. Big data cluster technologies is something a little bit different that we're using SQL 19. It's a part of SQL 19, but different, where we're going to combine Kubernetes and HDFS data, Spark, and SQL in different ways to build new AI applications. But not just AI applications, but analytic applications. So big data clusters being kind of something that's part of SQL, but a little bit different. And you still have the ability to do machine learning models with SQL Server aside from big data clusters. So with table deferred compilation, I'm proud to tell you today that you do no longer need a trace flag. That is built into the product. And it is enabled by using the new database compatibility level with SQL 19. So as soon as you turn that on, you have the capability to start using that functionality. So how similar is different to Databricks? Where can we use different languages, SQL querying, Spark Engine? So Databricks is, as you know, a cloud service using their Spark. And it's a great Azure service that we're providing. Our functionality is slightly different. We are using Apache Spark in our environment, but we provide a private cloud big data cluster on top of this where Spark is part of the story, but SQL Server is a big part of our story, whereas SQL Server is not part of Databricks. And so you have SQL Server or built-in T-SQL capabilities that we're doing with big data clusters, whereas, of course, with Databricks, Spark is your preferred language and Scala and other languages of that nature are using. With big data clusters, yeah, we write some similar functionality, but we're a private cloud environment that can run in Azure, but it's mostly, you know, right now we're kind of targeting that private cloud customer, but we're providing all the infrastructure using Kubernetes, and then I think the differentiator there a little bit is the T-SQL integration and the SQL engine integration than say what Databricks are providing. But Databricks is a great new Azure service we have, machine learning models, Spark running in that environment, still very exciting. One thing we're doing that's similar is we're offering Spark Notebook functionality in our Azure Data Studio. So as you can do Spark Notebooks in a Databricks environment, we have the same functionality running on our big data cluster as well. I think this question already got asked. You don't need this trace flag anymore. So turn on DB Compat 150 and you get a table deferred compilation. It says here, can't just TempDB replace with some system tables. I'm not sure exactly what that question is. But to be clear, what we're doing, the system tables for TempDB are not that large. So it shouldn't be very hard for us to actually make them schema-only memory-optimized tables. So it doesn't take a big footprint to do it. And it actually helps avoid a latch contention problem that you have no control over. You, of course, can do memory optimized tables in your database at any time you wish. And in fact, you could replace a temp table with a memory optimized table in your own user database. We've got documentation on how to do that. Any update on auto index defragging feature? So we don't really have necessarily an auto index defragging feature in database, but I really encourage you to look at the Tiger's adaptive defrag assistant they've got built in, which is a tool you can run that looks at telemetry in SQL Server and helps make more automated decisions for doing a defragmenting. What are the build in intelligence and performance tuning? I admit, guys, do you know what that one means? I'm not sure what that means. I don't know that question. I think you're dismissed. Yeah, sorry, I'd like to answer that, but I'm not sure exactly what that means. Maybe you can rephrase it. Do we need to give a hint to go to adaptive joins or inbuilt as it goes by default, or hints no use going forward? Hints are still viable option. There are still cases where a hint makes sense. Adaptive join is not available through a hint. It's something we would build in to a query plan. And remember, an adaptive join is one that makes a decision on whether to use like a hash or a nested loops join. So you still could force a certain join type, but adaptive join is one that makes decisions based on data. And so there's no hint for that, nor that it would make sense to do that. But so no, hints still have some value, but to be honest with you, we are trying to move towards a way where you don't have to worry as much about hints, but I still see hints having a future in very advanced query tuning scenarios. Will developer be able to use hints to invoke some kind of query plan to use for a particular query? You do have the ability today, I think I know the answer to this question, but with Query Store, of course you've had plan guides for a while, Query Store offers the ability to force a plan in the store. So as a developer, you could use stored procedures in Query Store based on a plan that we've stored, and you could force a particular query ID or a plan ID in the Query Store. So can SQL 19 be controlled through a mobile app? Boy, what a great idea. I'm sure there's somebody trying to think about doing a mobile app to control a SQL Server instance, but we do not have at Microsoft any announcements to make about a mobile app we've built that would manage a SQL Server. The next question is, can encryption cause performance issues? So encryption requires overhead no matter how you spin it, right? Anytime you use encryption, you usually have compute resources required to encrypt and unencrypt data. It just depends on the type of encryption and the amount of data you have. So transparent data encryption, for example, is something that's more costly at the write and read level because we're doing it at that level. Always encrypted always has a little bit of performance overhead because we're having to unencrypt and encrypt data even in the secure enclave. So there's always going to be some overhead. I don't have any numbers to tell you what that looks like. What we've seen over time, though, is we've actually made even some improvements in TDE as a functionality to make it more performant. But you should never think of encryption as something that will have no impact. We think you can use this technology in a way that will have a negligible impact for your application, but don't ever think it's something that won't, and you need to fully test that out. What are the new features there in SQL 19 for the SQL DBA? I would encourage you to go back and look at the deck again. I think, quite frankly, just about the entire section on performance, availability, and security, most of those were oriented towards a database administrator, although a developer certainly wants to know what those features look like so that they can write their app in a new and meaningful way. But think about, for example, think about intelligent query processing. Or think about lightweight query profiling. That's a better one. Lightweight query profiling on by default allows you as administrator to go in and look at the real-time execution of a query at the plan level anytime you want. It's a pretty significant feature for us to put in a SQL Server. If you look at availability groups for system databases, now you're, as an administrator, your configuration of SQL is a lot easier now once you have that functionality, because you don't have to set up some special system to replicate over agent jobs and logins and things of that nature. I'll let Amit and you guys address the recording of the webinar. I don't know the answer to that question. The question about Kubernetes is on Azure. Kubernetes is available on Azure, called Azure Kubernetes Service, but Kubernetes is an open source platform. So it's available in a lot of different ways and distributions on other cloud platforms and also on premises. So I encourage you to look at the Kubernetes website where it shows a list of all the various flavors of Kubernetes distributions that are available today. Our tutorials that we have right now are on Azure Kubernetes Service. It's easier for you to kind of see them in action. Big data clusters today, when you sign up for the private preview, we have the ability to do that with you both on Azure and a private cloud. Excuse me. Hi, Bob. What will happen with the connections after a failover with AG and Kubernetes? Will the sessions be killed? It's very similar for the sessions like you would experience in an AG scenario today. There'll be a disconnect and a reconnect that occurs. So anytime you lose a connection, you have to actually retry. So it's very similar to that, but the cool thing is that this load balancer service allows you to connect without having to know the new IP address of the new container node where it exists. So it's very similar to a retry connection. The accelerated data recovery will be applicable in case of failure while restoring the DB. So accelerated data recovery is baked into recovery, which would run and restore on a restart of SQL Server. It does use a persisted version store. But yeah, it'll be applicable to any case where you have recovery scenarios with SQL Server. Reporting app will work as a witness server. I don't know what that question is. I know reporting apps with Kubernetes with AGs can use a load balancer to read from secondaries, and it'll have the similar concept of doing retries when the secondaries fail. But I'm not sure what you mean by using as a witness server. We don't have that concept today. Did you enforce max DUP during execution of the query? Was that to only simulate the, I did max DUP to only just make it easier to see my demo. There was no special reason to force that. Lightweight query profiling works for any session that's running currently. That there's a plan that we can view. I just did that for the simplicity of seeing the demo. let's see here. Now SQL 19 is smart to handle unstructured big data. How if we call it? Hey, good joke. We're not going to call it NoSQL. So no, we're not going to call it that. Is Ostress similar to Linux? So Ostress is still only available for Windows, but it can connect to a Linux server. It's not available to run natively on Linux. Okay, we don't have the ability to restore databases between versions and editions of the same version to compat. So that's not totally true. You can restore a database across, first of all, you can store it across editions. That's not true. You can do that already. Now, it could be that there could be some feature of an edition that doesn't exist between an edition that you might have a problem with. But remember, our change in SQL 16 SP1, even things like column store work across editions. You can't downgrade editions with restore. You can't back up a database on SQL 19 and restore it to SQL 17. That hasn't changed. But you certainly can do it the other direction. And we still support the ability to restore a database or back up a database on 16, 17, and restore to a higher version. But you cannot restore to a lower version. But you can go between one edition to the other. During a Docker upgrade, as you showed, is downtime required? So the downtime is required because of the fact that SQL is not available while we're upgrading and scripting the new databases. So you get an error if you try to log into SQL. You get, like, say, SQL's in script update mode. But here's the key thing. If you go run that demo yourself, it takes like 2 minutes to do that. I mean, how long does it take you to patch a SQL new version of SQL today? It's pretty crazy, a long time, right? So in this particular case, my downtime was there, but just in a matter of minutes versus what it could be for something else doing another, like an in-place upgrade, for example, right? If there are adaptive joins, so no hints are required going forward. So that's not true. Adaptive joins is a great new technology to help you avoid maybe in some cases using hints, but I'm not here to tell you that you will never have to do a hint for whatever reason, hinting an index or a join order or a join type. It is our intention to try to reduce the amount of times you need to do those in the future, but doesn't necessarily mean that you will not need hints going forward. Are DBA's future still secure with such enhancements and automations? So Deepraj, that is a really, really good question. I'm glad you asked that because I get this question all the time. Like, is my job as an administrator DBA gone, right? My answer is definitively not, but I will tell you this. My personal opinion is I'm not sure that using the term DBA makes sense anymore. I mean, you're a data professional. And if you think about all the enhancements and things we're doing, your job may be to manage the SQL Server instance or the database or the data, right? Think about all the different features that we have that require somebody to understand that. And yeah, we have DevOps scenarios where devs are more involved, but DevOps involves more integration between people that have to operate. So if you think about your future, what you do today, it could be operation or management of a SQL Server or a database. And in the SQL Server environment, we still think that's completely needed. If you go look at big data clusters in itself, there's no way that entire thing just totally manages itself. It can't do that. Yes, our intention to make it easier to manage and more autonomous. And in fact, some of the automation we're putting in is very intentional. But the idea to put that in is not to remove your job. It's actually to make your job easier so you can focus on the most important aspects of keeping your SQL Server available and performant. Will SQL tables be on HDFS so Spark can use it natively? So you shouldn't think of it that way. You shouldn't think of SQL tables being HDFS. You should think of the ability to access unstructured data in a way natively with Spark or with SQL Server. And in fact, the SQL Server engine is integrated to read directly native data from HDFS. So if you think about JSON files, CSV files, Parquet files, those kind of types that are typically stored as unstructured data, it's our intention not for you to have to transform those into a table. We want you to be able to view that data like a table in a relational way or process it with things like Spark. Do we have any option to find out the actual space used by database snapshots from tables in recent versions? Top of my head, I thought there was a way to do that already. So if there's not, send me an email at bobward@microsoft.com and I'll work with you. But I thought we already had that capability already. Does Bob prefer Tony row mode in 19? Okay, that is funny. Okay, that you just may have made my day today, especially since my Cowboys won last night. That Tony row mode or Dak row mode, that's excellent. Somebody's a big Cowboys fan out there, so good job. Let's see. How data marts will be different from materialized views or, say, extracts in Tableau? So slightly different. It's similar, right? It's a similar concept, but I do want you to consider that these data marts could be large. Like you could be put, and they're actual tables. Using things like column store on top of them. So column store provides a more differentiation there. But unlike maybe some materialized views or extracts from Tableau, this data mart could be a significant amount of data that you want to cache as a result set in the data mart. AGs for system bases, will that be available for older versions? We haven't made a decision on that. We don't even have it available yet for 19. We're just planning it and we're telling you it's coming. But we have not made any decisions about when we put it in 19, would we put that in available in an older version of SQL Server? For edge analysis, which tools are available for SQL 19? I'm not sure exactly what you mean by that, but it is our intention to have SQL Server play a big part in IoT edge scenarios, and we're still working through what that looks like, and you should stay tuned for more announcements about what we'll be doing in that space. What is the scope of traditional SQL programmer and the new SQL Server? We want to learn some things more to do tasks on SQL, then please let us know. So I don't know what you mean by traditional SQL programmer, but the T-SQL language is still one of the most popular languages in the world to access data. And if you look at the enhancements we've made to SQL Server, we just keep extending that language. So all that skills that you have with T-SQL will not be wasted. So we're not getting rid of it. In fact, this is a really funny question, because if you think about any other database out there, like even Cosmos DB or other NoSQL databases, now HDFS, everybody wants to mimic SQL on top of it, because SQL is, an easier programming language to manage data. So those traditional SQL programming skills will not go away. In fact, learning the new enhancements and extensions of SQL is the important part. Even like what we did with Java. You want to put a Java program with SQL, you still got to use T-SQL to integrate it together. With new intelligent query processing features being released with SQL, will it roll out to SQL 17? We don't have any announcements to make about backporting any changes for IQP in previous releases of SQL Server. It's something we'll certainly look at, but we have no announcements today to make for that. would it become eventually to call external language from SQL function? Oh yeah, so it's a great question. Like, would we do, like, instead of doing a Java as a system store procedure, could you build it into a function? We're certainly looking at new ways for this Java functionality to make it more easier to integrate in the SQL language. I will tell you this though, it's not really a cursor. Don't think of it that way, because the Java program can iterate over these results. In a way, it is kind of a row by row, if you want to think of it that way. It can be that way. But Java has capabilities to operate on data on more than a row-by-row basis. So it doesn't have to be a cursor-like result. But I hear what you're saying, and we're thinking about new ways to try to integrate things like Java into T-SQL through things like functions. But we have no announcements today to make on that. Will Profiler be deprecated in 19 and handle the job to extended events? So first of all, Profiler has already been marked as deprecated in previous releases of SQL Server, as are the SQL trace functionalities in the engine. But they have not been removed, and we have no plans right now to remove them. But it's no question that our preferred method for you to trace SQL Server is extended events. And you should take a look at both Management Studio and Azure Data Studio, which have new, what's called SQL Profiler capabilities to make things easier to use and profile extended events just like you were used to using SQL Profiler. So it's our intention that's the future, but we have not removed SQL Profiler from the product. Let's see, intelligent query processing. If I'm not wrong, the query store shows only the live query execution. In that case, if I want to analyze a query that ran for a long time, including non-working hours, will it be possible? So let's think of it this way. I think you meant I think you meant lightweight query profiling from your question. I'm looking at this here. So lightweight query profiling is to look at a query in progress. Once that query finishes, then you look at query store to see the after effects of the query. So that's why we think of this anytime, anywhere possibility. You could look at the estimated plan before it ran. You could use lightweight query profiling to see how it's running, and then query store after the fact. Greetings from Finland. I just want to say thank you for listening at Orlando. New car damage problems, blah, 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 and fixing SP1. Oh, well, great. Great to hear from you from Finland. That's a long ways from here, from Texas. And great to hear that you've got a solution from that event in Orlando intersection. Wow, Amit. Satya, what do you guys think? That was a lot. But we got through it.
Yes, we have got through this, Bob, and more questions might come in, and we will redirect the attendees to the right forums to post questions. And as we always do, Microsoft and MVPs will answer questions whenever the time is there. So
I got to tell you, man, thank you guys so much. I had fun. I mean, I'm not sure if I've seen that much energy from a webinar in a long time. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Bob, for all your time. And it was, you have enjoyed, and we have enjoyed as much putting all this together for the community.
Awesome.
Thank you very much, Bob. Thank you, attendees. And wherever you are from, have a good day. And if you are in this part of the world, India and beyond, have a good sleep with SQL.
Yeah, have a good sleep. Take care, guys.
Yeah, thank you, Bob. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good day. Bye.